Good morning, everyone. Welcome back to Using PASER and WISLR to Manage Your Roads. I'm Ben Jordan with the Transportation Information Center. In this session, our third session, we're going to be talking about using WISLR to enter pavement ratings and to update pavement ratings. And joining us is Isaac Park. Isaac is WISLR Pavement Coordinator and Data Analyst with WISDOT. And I'll turn it over to you, Isaac.
Thank you, Ben. Hello, everyone. My name is Isaac Park, and I will be training you this session. As Ben mentioned, I am the pavement coordinator for the Wisconsin DOT. So I will be your point of contact for everything pavement related, including the pavement rating submissions that are due this year. This isn't a live session, but if you have any questions, you can feel free to send them to Wisconsin DOT. Contact information will be included at the end of this lesson. In the previous training sessions, we went over quite a number of things. We went over WISLR 101, how to manage your pavement inventory, and how to make any updates to your pavement inventory. And we also went over PASER ratings themselves. So the focus of this session is to go into how to actually enter your pavement ratings once you've collected them from the field. So we're gonna do a brief review over how PASER ratings work again. We're gonna look at how to navigate to the pavement rating entry screen. We'll go over your other options for submitting pavement ratings other than using the WISLR website. And finally, we'll do some tips and tricks. So on the screen, I have Wisconsin's state statute requirement for pavement ratings. It's a lot of words there, but the short story is your pavement ratings are due every 2 years on December 15th, starting on the odd years. So for example, this year is 2023, an odd year, and your pavement ratings are due this year. Pavement ratings must be submitted by all local governments and counties. What you're responsible for submitting is pavement ratings for roads that are just in your local jurisdiction that are eligible for general transportation aid. So this does not include state highways, connecting highways, county forest roads, or any roads that are outside of your jurisdiction. On the screen here, we have some dates to remember. Every odd calendar year, you will receive a letter from Wisconsin DOT, an email to be more accurate, in May. So some of you have already received an email from me this year in May. This goes over the state requirements for your pavement ratings, as well as some instructions and frequently asked questions about submitting them. In March and December is when you will start your visual inspection for all roads in your jurisdiction. And on December 15th is the day that pavement ratings must be submitted by. So anytime between March and December 15, you're able to send your pavement ratings. And on this screen here, we're going to go over your submittal options. There is the Web WISLR website, which is the main focus of this training session today. And this is just where you can enter your pavement ratings directly through the web and submit and save them directly. Your second option is to use an Excel spreadsheet. You can either fill them out in Excel and email it to Wisconsin DOT, or you can print it out and either print it out the copy that you've saved, or you can hand fill out your spreadsheet and you can send it to Wisconsin DOT by paper mail. Not shown here is the option to use a GIS shapefile for municipalities that have access to a GIS system. And if you would like to use a shapefile, you will need to email Wisconsin DOT and request a shapefile, and we will send you a fresh shapefile for your municipality that you can fill out and send back to us. And why do we want to push this electronic method? It is easier for both Wisconsin DOT and the municipalities. And our goal is to have over 90% of all municipalities submitting pavement rates ratings electronically. And as you can see, over the years, we are actually very close to that goal. There was actually a total drop in submissions in the year 2020 and 2021. But the vast majority of municipalities are now sending them electronically, either through a shape file, a spreadsheet, or using WISLR. One question that many people may have is, can you have a third party do your pavement rating submittals for you? And the answer is yes. So we'll just discuss briefly what that means. It can be either a consultant, a metropolitan planning organization, a regional planning commission, or a county planning organization. And the way to do this would be for your local chair to send your information, which municipality is making the request, as well as a third party information, who you would like to give access to your data and to submit the pavement ratings, and just sending either a paper mail or email saying that you grant that third party authorization to do your pavement ratings for you. This cannot be done by phone. Wisconsin DOT will then send you a receipt of notice, and within 3 business days, we will confirm and process your third party. Now, one thing that we are assuming for this lesson is that you already have access to WAMS and WISLR. If you're not sure how to do that, information is included in the manuals, as well as the previous trainings in WISLR 101 that was done earlier. So what we have on the screen now is actually the very first screen that you will see when you log into WISLR. On the screen, you can see we have that map of Wisconsin. And then we also have a dropdown where you can select your county and your municipality. So that is one way to choose your municipality. And the second option that you see underneath it is more for power users. We do have an option to put your county muni code. And so that's just a combination of your county number and your municipality. You can see those numbers in the dropdown when you select them as well, if you don't know what it is, but it is either or. You do not need to fill out everything on here. So once you have your county and municipality selected, you can click continue and you'll get to the main menu of WISLR. So we're gonna open up our main menu. On the bottom right, we have our menu. And then we have an arrow here, points Web WISLR pavement rating entry screen. So when we click on this, this will take us directly to our pavement entry screen. All right, so now that we've clicked on pavement rating entry, we see this screen pop up, and there's a lot going on here, and we're gonna go through it one by one. Sorry about that. So at the very top of our screen, we've got our Getting Started button, which will give you information and instructions, going over more or less what you see in this training today, as well as resources. This will be general information about pavement ratings and also like how PASER works. We will see what this looks like in the demo, but if you're ever lost, feel free to go and click on them and look at them for reference. We have a number of other buttons here on the screen as well. We have update all rating years and update. And we will show you how this works in the demo as well. But what this will do is it will automatically fill in your current rating years with a rating of 2023. So for some people that need to update only the years, this can save you a number of clicks. So we will show you how that works in the demo. And finally, we've got spreadsheet instructions on the right-hand side, right next to our print download spreadsheet button. And this will give you the instructions for using the spreadsheet if you choose to use that as your submittal option. Circled in red, we've got our main pavement rating sections here. So on the left-hand side of this table, and you can see in this table, we have one row for every segment of road. So Adams Street has a road, Adams Way has a row. And for most people that have a very simple workflow, all you need to do is put your pavement rating in the boxes on the left. And once you put your rating for each segment of road, you can select Save Changes on the top right, and that will save your new pavement ratings. WISLR will be updated as soon as you press Save. Our recommendation is to save frequently. Otherwise, if you do have internet issues or your browser crashes, or even if you take a very long time, you might time out your connection, you would lose any work that happened since the last time you saved. So about once per page is a good idea, is our recommendation, but the more the better. It doesn't hurt to save too often. One thing to note is that when you press save, WISLR or Wisconsin DOT is not actually notified at that point. So you can save as many times as you want. You will only send out your notification to us once when you press send submittal at the right-hand side. So the set and submittal button right here, you click at the very end of your process. That will just give you one final checklist of things to make sure. And when you send submittal, that's what informs DOT that you are done entering your pavements. Now, above these save changes and save send submittal buttons, we have a print download spreadsheet button. And this is what you can print, you can press to get a spreadsheet. And there is more than one use. So there is the use for sending Wisconsin DOT a spreadsheet instead or a printout. But you can also use this to get a record of your pavement ratings once you're done or even before your start. So either way. What the spreadsheet will do is it will show you the last saved pavement ratings in years. So many municipalities use this as a way to keep track of everything they've done once they send it. So you can kind of use it as a receipt of your own records of what you entered. At the very top of the screen, at the top right, we have a close button. This you can use when you're done saving all your changes and submitting to just close your window. It will take you back to the main menu. All right, so let's look at some options for people that need to make more changes than just your pavement ratings. By default, all of these extra options are unchecked, and that saves a little bit of space, which is why for most people that only need to change their pavement ratings, we don't have these on. Your options are update surface data, updating offset data, and updating your local ID. So let's take a look at what it looks like with these options on. All right, so this is a screenshot of your pavement rating table with the additional update options. In green, we've got update surface data. So as you can see, these are the columns that correspond to your surface type, the surface year, and surface width. So if you need to make any changes, so for example, an unpaved gravel road to asphalt, you can use the update surface data to change that surface type. When you change the surface type, just make sure you update the year as well and the surface width if it's applicable. In purple, we have update offset data. So these are your at offset and the segment lengths. You will use this when you need to split or combine sections of road in the system. This is related to that on at toe directional directional system that we covered in WISLR 101 and the PASER training. And we will talk a little bit more about splitting and combining segments of road later on in this training session. And finally, in red, we have update local ID, the right-hand side. And this is where you can put your own local names for segments of road. This is a very free-form field. Anyone can use it the way they need to. And it's used to identify segments of road by your own personal identifiers. So we've got update surface data, update offset data, and our local ID. So the next section here is discussing this view by intersection option. This is a checkbox right next to your county and municipality. So by default, WISLR will show you a row for each intersection on a road. So in our example here in Little Chute, we have 526 items when we're viewing by intersection. And on Adams Way, we have two rows from McKinley Avenue to Pierce and Pierce Avenue to Adams Street. So let's see what happens when we click this checkbox off. So with this view by intersection off, we now see that there are less items on the screen. So from 526, we now have 315 items. And we see Adams Way in purple only has one row. It's going from McKinley Avenue all the way down to Adams Street. So those two rows were combined into one. The next option that we want to let everyone know about is how to expand your worksheet. So by default, this is off. It gives you the most amount of options to view. And we see that it only shows 10 rows at a time. So we have rows 1 to 10 shown on the screen right now. When we check this checkbox, we start hiding more of the screen. So a lot of our options, all of our offset options, they no longer appear. So you see there's nothing where they were before. And we now show rows 1 to 16. So a lot more of your screen space is spent showing you just your pavement ratings. You can now update 16 of them at a time before navigating to the next page. So what creates a pavement segment? This is very closely related to that view by intersection option that we discussed right before. There are 8 values that determine what is a unique pavement segment. So we've got arrows pointing. We have surface year, surface width, your on route, your at route, your at offset, your toward route, and your local ID, segment length and local ID. So if any of these values are different, WISLR will always consider them as two different pavement segments. So for example, if your surface year, even if you're on the same road name, Adams Street, if there was another year, different year, like a segment that has a 2022 year, that will be split off automatically by the system. And we will show you how this works in our demo as well, if you wanted to see a hands-on demonstration of how that splitting and combining works. If all of these values are the same, WISLR will consider it one segment and combine them. So especially if you have that view by intersection checkbox off, you will see only the sections of road where all of these values are the same. All right, so we're gonna take a look now at how WISLR handles our offsets. We use offsets to define the breaks in our segments of road. So we've got view by intersection on here, but we're gonna take a look at this section of Airport Road. We see that it's going from Enchanted Valley to Hillcrest Drive, but this segment length is 1,373. And the next segment of road starts from that offset of 1,373 and goes on another 581 miles or feet. So why do we have this segment here split, even though they're at the same street, the same at route, the same tort route? And the answer here is that the first segment of road, the first 1,373 feet, have a surface width of 24 feet. And the second road, the last 581 feet, has a surface width of 40. So WISLR, seeing this difference, automatically splits it at that offset into two different rows, two different segments of road. So sometimes it's a little bit easier to visualize this through a map. We do have on every segment of road a yellow Wisconsin icon next to the road name, and this will open a map. So we've got Airport Road from Enchanted Valley to Hillcrest Drive on our screen. And we see the map colors it in two different segments. Our first segment goes from zero, the very beginning of Enchanted Valley Road and Hillcrest or Airport Road, to that 1,373rd offset. So we can see this section length is 1,373. And our second road segment is this lighter green color. It's going from the same 1,373 offset all the way to the next 581 feet. And it's got that section length here, 581. So you can actually visualize these breaks in the road by clicking that yellow Wisconsin icon to open a map like this. It's just a one-click feature. Finally, once we save, WISLR will do some error checks for you. And you will see at the top left-hand corner a message box if there were any errors in your pavement ratings. There is a show error message checkbox that it's referring to you. And if you click on it, it will actually give you a list of every segment of road that has an error. These segments of road are highlighted in red, so you will be able to see them visually as well when you go through your pavement ratings again. Once you've completed your pavement ratings and fixed all your errors, it's now time to save and submit your pavement ratings. And the two buttons that we've mentioned before are Save Changes and Submittal, circled in red at the top right. So as we mentioned before, save often, send once. Once you're done and you send your submittal, you will get that confirmation email, both to Wisconsin DOT and to yourself. All right, so now that we've gone over entering your pavement ratings, let's just briefly discuss our spreadsheet. You can download your spreadsheet, but you will need Microsoft Excel 2000 or higher to open it. And you might also need Adobe Reader so that you can open the spreadsheet instructions. The spreadsheet is formatted to fit legal size paper, but if you just have regular printer paper, 8.5 by 11, Excel will shrink that to fit. So you don't have to worry too much if you just need to print something out. Some municipalities do request that printout to be mailed to them. If you would like a paper copy mailed to you, you can send us an email at our contact information that we'll share, and you will receive a spreadsheet in the mail. And this is just a screenshot of what the instructions look like. It actually discusses a lot of what we already went over in this training, but it's just describing what every column in the spreadsheet represents. And here's just the view of what that spreadsheet looks like. On the left-hand side, we have our two columns for pavement rating and rating year. Looks very similar, works very similarly to the website itself. And this is where you would enter your pavement rating and your year for every segment of road. The fourth column, column D, will show you the currently saved pavement rating and year. So if you haven't started your pavement ratings and saved it yet, you will actually just show the last rating that was submitted to Wisconsin DOT. And these other columns all correspond to the same identification that we discussed that we see in the website. And now we've got our at and towards column. This can be used to identify segments of road that do not start at in your municipality. So whether it's a county highway or a road that you share with another municipality. In our example here, we have 44040 as our column. And if we can look at our own municipality, it's 44146. So it just shows that there's a road that starts in a different municipality. Our toward municipality location works the same way. There will be a code for that municipality if there is any road that ends outside of your municipality. And finally, we'll just talk about how missing data works in this spreadsheet. So sometimes you have either invalid data or missing data that was previously saved. So in our example, we have Berry Lane. There's no current pavement rating in year, so it's blank. And then this surface type has NA, which stands for not applicable. So in our example here, this NA means that there's no surface type or surface year entered, which is why we're not able to show a value there. If you do come across this situation, you can fill in the surface type and year next to that field. I would write it in. Or you can update that segment of road in WISLR like we showed you in managing your inventory. All right, finally, how to submit it. So if you filled it out in Excel, you're free to send this to us via email and we will load them for you. Our email is ratingsubmittal@dot.wi.gov. So this is just for the rating submittals. We did have another contact information for general questions. If you wanted to send it to us through paper mail, this is our address, PO Box 7913. So that would be for people that filled it out by hand and want to mail it to us. Now let's go over some tips and tricks of frequently asked questions. The first thing we want to talk about are these funny little numbers that show up once in a while. So we have Bass Lake Road, and one section has a 1, and two other sections have a 2. And what does that mean? The number in parentheses is an extension that WISLR uses to distinguish parts of road that have the same name, but are not the same section, the same piece of road. So what you would see on your road sign would not be this 1 or 2. You would see only Bass Lake Road for both of these sections. And in our example, we do include the map. Bass Lake Road 1 is going from east to west. And Bass Lake Road 2 is going from north to south. So these kind of Y intersections where it splits into two different roads with the same name, that would be a situation where you would see these extra numbers. The second name issue that we get a lot of questions about are these slashes. Sometimes you have more than one route listed on the same name. So in our example, we've got Bass Lake Court and Bass Lake Road. And usually only one of these will be a real name that you'll see on the road sign. But the second name might have been either a historical name or a secondary name that was entered in our system. So that's what the slash stands for. And if we look at a map here, we've got Bass Lake Road 2 and Bass Lake Court here. And there's like this Bass Lake Route just branching out from that intersection there. So it's kind of got both names in our system. And that concludes the demo or the slideshow presentation of rating your roads. Here is our contact information if you need to reach us. We have wislrinfo@dot.wi.gov. This email address is good for any questions that you have to the Wisconsin DOT. And here's our phone number. If you need to reach us by phone, it's 608-266-2865. And you will just be asked to leave your name, your county, your municipality, and a brief description of your question and concern. And the right person will get back to you, depending on which team it should go to. And finally, you can contact us through our website, through WISLR. There should be contact information there as well. Thank you. We will now do a brief demonstration of our rating system in action.
Thank you, Isaac.
Thank you.
Before jumping into the demonstration, one question that comes up in this part of the presentation is, if I've submitted my ratings through WISLR, do I also have to submit a spreadsheet?
Nope. So you only need to send your ratings once. Once you press save, WISLR is already updated, so there's no more changes that need to be made to the system. And that send submittal button will send WISLR the email saying that you're done with your ratings. So once you save in WISLR, you don't need to send us anything else.
Thank you.
All right. Do people see my Wisconsin map on the screen right now?
Yes.
Okay. So this is the screen that appears when you log into WISLR. We've got our map of Wisconsin and our drop downs that we've mentioned. And let's see here. Okay. So let's start by selecting our county. And for this demonstration, I'm going to click on Little Chute in Auto Grainy. And this is a training and test environment. So don't worry if you're from out of gamey, we're not changing anything in your municipality. And I've selected our county and muni, and I'm gonna click continue. And this will open our menu. And we've got Web WISLR on our screen. I'm just gonna click on this link to open. It's going to take a moment to load. All right, I'll just give a couple seconds for it to load on people's screens. And let me, it's a little bit awkward of a size here. I'll just zoom in and scroll as needed. So as we mentioned, at the top left, getting started and our resources. So if we click on getting started, this will open how to use Web WISLR to update your pavement ratings. So it actually looks similar to what you had in the manual if you were following on, but just our pavement rating sections. So this will go over everything we discussed today with screenshots. So if you need some steps to help you, this is a guide here. And then if you click on resources, just give a couple seconds to load. This will give you some more general information about pavement ratings. So it's going to give you a guide about some frequent questions about route name changes and actually, yeah, so rating surface mismatch. And what I want to show everyone at the very bottom of this guide is this section here, surface type and PASER rating table. So this covers a lot of what we talked about on Tuesday's session about PASER ratings. But if you ever need to know the type code for your surface type or the ratings that each correspond to, that's in this resources document at the top. Okay, so let's just go over some uses for updating your pavement. I'm just scrolling down. It's not disappearing. So if we want to update our pavement ratings, you can click on your row and type a pavement rating. So for example, if this first section of road is 7, we just type 7. And then we click the next road and do our next road one by one. Now, for some people, they might find that they are often not changing their roads very much for our pavement rating cycle. If you have that situation in your municipality, we do have an update all rating years button at the top. And if you click update, we'll just show what happens here. If we were to scroll down, we see that pavement ratings are already filled in. And all it does is it copies your last rating and puts it in your current rating box. So this helps if you have a lot of roads, but you know that only like one road here. So for example, if only Apostolic Road has changed from an 8 to a 5, but everything else is the same, this will save you a number of clicks. But it's kind of an edge case because most people have a little more changes than just one or two. So the caveat is that you see that we have 526 roads. Every single one is updated. So if we were to go to another page, we'll see it all updated there. So it's a bit dangerous if you have a lot more changes because it will fill in a lot of things that you might not want to fill in. Now let's click on update surface data. You get a pop-up letting you know to make sure your gear and width are correct. And we see it takes a little bit more space on your screen now, which is kind of why we turn it off in the beginning. And it lets you change. So if I wanted to change this concrete pavement on Bohm Road to asphalt, that's how you would do that. So let me just change it back. Then you can update your ratings as well too, or your year. That's how you would update your surface year and width. So if I were to save here, so I'm changing this road to asphalt. And if I were to save, I'm on Bowman County Highway. So might take a little bit of time to save. So you'll just hang on tight while it says, please wait. Don't need to click on anything or close. Sorry for those watching live. this might just be our test environment being a little bit slow. For most people, it should be pretty quick.
Isaac, does that also have to do with the fact that we did the update all rating years, so it was saving all of those rating changes as well?
I don't think it normally makes a big difference.
Okay.
Most of the time when I'm saving, almost every year is changed anyways. So I don't think that's the problem itself. So, okay. So in our example here, we see all our pavement ratings are now updated to 2023. And we've got a concrete pavement on Boehm Drive. And if I were to click on this map button, we see our map loading. There's Boehm Drive. Okay, so yeah, Boehm Drive highlighted in blue. And I think, yeah, over here, the default legend is by their pavement rating. So it's got a good pavement rating here. All right. And as we mentioned, we press save. At the top, we do see that there were some errors. So not all data was successfully saved. So let's click on our show error messages. And it shows that we've got certain roads, Don DeGroote Drive with an error. Rating does not match pavement type. So let's try to see what's going on there. So we've got Don DeGroote Drive. This was a feature that we didn't really show on the slide, but we've got select route. And this drop down where it says find drop route, it gives you a list of every road that you have in your municipality. So if we were to find Don DeGroote Drive, I'm going to slowly navigate there. And I'm going to click on Don DeGroote Drive. We see that we've now jumped directly to page 10. And the reason it jumped to that page specifically is because Don DeGroote Drive is on this page. Now we can see that it's highlighted in red. And we've got a rating mismatch here. So in this particular section here, I'm not seeing what would cause a rating surface mismatch. There might have been a funny number entered before. I don't actually know what's centered there, but if someone put like a 12 or a 13, you're gonna get an error message. That's probably what I did. I think I might have put a and if there was no rating as well, you'd see that NA. So to fix this error, all we would have to do would be to put a real rating here. So this is just a test environment, so we're just going to put a 7 here. Obviously put your real rating if you know what it is in your county. And you would do that for every road that has a rating. Now, if you save this and you don't fix every road, the system will still save everything else. So it's not that those errors stop everything else from being good. So if you have just one or two roads, it can't be fixed in pavement ratings or pavement entry, and you need to go out and either contact WISLR to get some segment of road fixed up. That's perfectly fine. You can still save and you can still send. It will just save everything but the roads that have errors. So don't worry too much if you have that situation. Another thing I'd like to show you now is just a brief example of how splitting works. So we did discuss that earlier, but say we have, and I'm gonna check update offset data so we can start splitting it and update local ID. And I'm gonna shrink this a little so you can see it all. So say that we were on Depot Street here at County Highway N towards Hans Parkway, and we needed to make a change. What's going to happen? So say I just changed part of this highway to a 40-foot width, and I want it to be just the first 200 feet of the road. So out of 475, just 200. So this change, once we save, so I was on Depot Street, and just refresh here. Sometimes you need to refresh to make a change. I think this time it actually showed instantly. But if you see that your offsets haven't updated, you just want to refresh here. So I'm on Depot Street. And we see our section here, 0 to 200, 40 feet. Let me just wait a couple seconds so people can load the screen. The row I'm looking at is this second row. We see our 40 foot that we entered, and we see that it goes from 0 to 200 feet. And in the second row, right underneath it, we see that it's gone from 43 feet. So that was what it originally was as our surface width. And it's going from 200 to the last 275 feet of road. So that's how you split it if you need to make a change like that. Might be an extra step depending on what changes you need to make, but it's not too difficult. And you can certainly ask us for help if you need us to walk you through it. All right, and now if we were to look at our map, so at any given point, if you need to just see what you did, you can always click on that map button. And we see now we've got our segment of road here. Now, if I were to undo that change, so I'm going back to 43 feet. Now we'll just show you what happens here. It's pretty cool. So remember here, right now it says 43, 0 to 200. Or before it said 40, 0 to 200. But I'm going to change it back to 43. Okay. And this is what I mentioned here. It says 43 here, 0 to 200. But if we were to refresh our screen, so yeah, you do need to refresh for the changes like that to show up. We see here Depot Street is now one segment again, 0 to 475. So if we click on our map, now it's just one segment of road. So before it had that two segments. Very good. All right, looks like we have a couple questions in chat. I'll go double check these now. From Shelly Salvola, we have, our screen shows a 2023 update. How come our current rating shows a 2019 rating year? It is my understanding that it is to be done every 2 years. So might have to take a look at your municipality in greater detail later. But I think sometimes, especially people that mail them in, I see they don't always fill in that year. So if you save it without having that updated year, and in our case here, it defaulted 2023, so it wouldn't happen in our case. It could just be that that's how it was entered. It might be user error. So I think that's a good way to check, especially when you're done with your pavement ratings. If you were to click print download spreadsheet, I'll just show this on the screen. So it downloaded our spreadsheet. And if we were to open it, and you can see all of your payment ratings and years in this fourth column. So this would be a good way to just double check for your own records if you accidentally didn't update the right years, just to make sure you did it. So if all the ratings are right and it's just the year that was wrong, that would definitely be a good use of this update all buttons, because it's going to fill in everything you already put in, but it's going to put in the new year as well.
Isaac, would it also be possible that the ratings were not submitted or did not get saved for the 2021 rating period if they're seeing 2019 as their current rating year?
That is also a possibility. So if you forgot to press save or your computer crashed or something and you press send submittal without saving, it would send us the email, but it wouldn't send update the numbers. So that's the kind of thing, like if that happened, you might get an email list from us later on. We do send some reminders for the people that are scraggling, saying that your updates weren't sent to us with the right years. So if all of your ratings are 2019, for example, you might get a email in 2021 towards the end of December or towards closer to December saying you might need to make sure you update your payment ratings. So that is another possibility if it just didn't save properly.
And if that was the case and they're in 2023 now, and if all the ratings shown in current year are shown as 2019 and they look at the rating numbers and they know those were 2019 numbers, if they had their 2021 numbers, they could enter those just by changing the rating year in the pull down and entering the 2021 numbers before they entered the 2023 numbers, correct?
Yeah, you can do that. I think it might be a little bit of extra work since you're already in 2023. I think I would just change it all to 2023. I think it's too much extra entry here to put 2021 years.
for our purposes, we'd love to see the data for those years, because at some point we may be able to use the trends on deterioration to update some of the deterioration curves that are built in behind this system. So it is always good to get your data in there. And you can see trends also a little better as you see how those ratings are changed at each 2 year time cycle. So I'd certainly encourage someone, if they didn't get in and you have them for that missing 2 year rating period, it would be good to get them into the system. So,
okay. Yep. And if that happens, ideally before 2023.
Yeah.
I think we might be able to track, but.
The next question is kind of an interesting one.
Okay. One more thing.
Sure.
If you do want to change everything to just 2021 or 2022, for example, there is this drop down at the top next to the update years to just 2022, for example. And if you click on that and click update, it'll put 22 in our new rating years. So that is another feature that's out there in that particular situation.
And in doing that, then it also transferred over the rating year. I mean, I'm sorry, transferred over the rating to the new payment rating column as well.
Right. Okay. But, for example, if you're entering your ratings in 2023 and you know that every rating was done in 22, it will still save a lot of clicks because by default, everything's going to be 2023. But if you know you need to do, even if you have to type in a new button, you're also going to need to update this dropdown.
Right.
So it'll save some clicks.
It will save you a lot. Yep.
All right. Sounds like we had another question.
Yeah. And I'm thinking about how to answer the next question, because it's from Chris. And Chris says, should you reduce the width of the road based on encroaching vegetation or degradation? Encroaching vegetation, I would say no. You might want to take care of that encroaching vegetation in your maintenance processes, but it hasn't changed the width of the pavement. So no, I wouldn't change that. degradation of the road, you know, typically that's going to be kind of localized, and you're really only going to want to record width, kind of typical width for the segment, really, is what you should record. And so unless something's happened that you've gotten so much degradation in that pavement that the typical width has changed, I would not change the width. So in most cases, I would say no. And for some of your roads that, you know, kind of evolved over time, you, if you measure the width in a number of different locations, you're likely to find slightly different widths. So you may be, you know, kind of, especially on rural roads with shoulders, you may be kind of putting in an average there, you know, average typical number. You're not going to break segments up because it's a half foot wider or narrower in 100 foot segment than the next, because that isn't very practical to do. So usually that's going to be a change in width because there's a design transition in the width of the road.
All right. Christina had a good question that everybody would probably be interested in. She wants to know if you have access to recordings of this session. And yes, there will be a recording up. I mentioned there might have been an issue. If there was, I will be re-recording this. So don't worry, you will have access to everything we discussed in video form.
Yeah, after. And the recordings will get posted into the Canvas course site, and they will be set up so that in addition to be able to view them on the site, you will be able to download them as well. And so you could download them and save them on your computer for later reference.
All right. I think Nick had a follow-up. If he noticed that the last time the pavement was done in 2019, what to do now? I would just make sure you get your 23 ratings and just start fresh. Don't worry too much about 2021. All right. I think I've shown you pretty much anything that you can do. It is very straightforward, especially if all you need to do is enter ratings. I'll just show you what happens when you press send submittal. You'll get a warning saying, are you sure you're done? And once you press OK, it just sends an email. And I didn't have my email open, so you won't see a pop-up, but you will get an email almost immediately saying that you've submitted your ratings for this year. And Wisconsin DOT, we'll get all that information. We'll do a couple extra checks to make sure you've got enough pavement. So simple things like making sure your ratings are up to date your year. And if everything's good, you're good until 2025, the next 2 years. Any other questions for today? Anything you would like me to show you?
There's a question, what month is information typically submitted by municipalities? I send ours late to capture as much maintenance and resurfacing as possible that we've done during the year. So is there kind of a typical time or a peak time when these are getting submitted, or, you know, is it just different agencies submit them throughout the year?
I see ratings return to me as early as May, and I see some counties and municipalities even sending me them every year. So as long as you have them by December 15th on the odd years, really there's no pattern as far as which month is more popular, really. So anytime you're ready, when you have them, is the best time.
And with Josh's question about, I send them in late to capture as much maintenance and resurfacing as possible. Mm-hmm. The agency could also go in at other times and update that maintenance information as well.
That is correct.
And they don't have to wait and do that all at one time every 2 years.
Yeah. As I mentioned, some munis actually send me these every year. So you can make it as accurate and as frequent as you like, as long as you do it every 2 years at least.
All right. So All right. We have dueling Josh's here because that was Josh G. And now we've got question from Josh. All our rating years say 2023, but the last time we rated them was in 2021. How can we change them back to 2021 so we can track which ones we still need to rate in 2023?
So if you want to change everything to 2021, that would be another use of this update, all your years. So right now in our example, we've got 2023. I'm just going to say, oops, we didn't actually update everything. So we're going to start fresh, turn everything to 2021. And we see our rating numbers are defaulted. They're all exactly the same, but our new rating year is now 2021. And if we save, it's going to update our current year. So I'll just give a couple seconds here for it to load on people's screens.
While that's uploading, we got a flurry of questions. And so I'm trying to catch a few of them. And we're seeing it. Go ahead. Now it updated. So go ahead.
So now we see that our current years are showing as 2021. We can now go back and change anything that was updated to 2023. So it's just entering a new year. So in this particular situation, for example, if you have 10 and 2021 and you want it to be 10 and 2023, you do still need to put a year because we'd only change things that have a change here. You'll want to make sure anything that updates has that new pavement rating entered here. But that's how you would do it. Next questions, if we don't have any follow-ups to that.
Yeah. Okay, we go back to Josh G. He says, are historical PACER ratings available so we can run reports to show trends? This could be useful for showing our elected officials.
So that would be something I would send to WISLR info, that email address. Okay. If depending on your request, and we might want to refine what you're looking for depending on exactly how you're going to use it. But yeah, if there are ways to look back, but it's not a one-click process. If you haven't done your ratings yet, you will get your most recent ones if you click print spreadsheet. But other than that, it gets a little more complicated. So you'll want to contact WISLR.
And Isaac, maybe you and I will chat about that for a minute sometime before the afternoon session. And maybe we can address that a little bit as well. Next question. Okay, another question about access to recording. Yes, you'll have access to recordings. Is there a way that a map can be generated for the entire municipality that shows the upgraded existing pavement ratings? And that's really something we'll touch on. We should be able to touch on that in the afternoon session, right?
Yes. So we have a lot of pavement analysis tools that are just for that very question that you're asking.
Next question. We have a number of dead end roads. How are they entered?
So I don't know if I have any easy ones here. So for example, if you see my screen at the bottom, you've got Eben Road, Buchanan Street. So I'll just give a couple seconds for people's screens to update. But we see here that this at column, if I were to shrink it. So here we have on road, and then at and toward. And then at Eben Road to Buchanan. So this is our at, and it's going towards. It says termini here. So termini just means end of road, not at an intersection. So dead ends would typically have termini as their towards route.
All right, next question. I don't know, Isaac, maybe I take this one. Back to road rating. If one lane of a road was milled and overlaid, what would be used for the rating? we don't really have a way to split a road in WISLR by direction. And so I think you would still use the rating of the, in that case, I would probably use the lower rating of the two lanes. But there's, you know, there's nothing in terms of kind of WISDOT guidance that would say you have to use one or the other. But I think that would be my approach, because you're gonna want to plan, obviously, in the future, that lane that has not been milled and overlaid has some deterioration. It'll have some future deterioration. So the whole road's not gonna deteriorate like the newer portion. So I would use the lower rating of the two in that case. I think we talked in the first session, just touched on places where you could record comments about a culvert or other items like that in the inventory when Shelley was doing that, going through that on the first session. And so there's a question about that, where to record comments about culverts, et cetera. And Shelley mentioned you can use the route comments feature to record. That's under the main menu. So it's really something you do more with the inventory. Using WISLR as a budgetary tool, stay tuned for the afternoon session. That's what Isaac and I are going to be doing. We're going to be showing you the pavement analysis tools, showing you how you can put in proposed budget amounts for each year of five-year program and have WISLR give you a recommended pavement program for those 5 years. So that's a big highlight of what we're going to talk about after lunch. We have several roads where water or sewer crossings that are now gravel were done. Does this change the ratings of these roads? Ken is asking that question. And Ken, if I'm not understanding the question, you can always add something in the chat or open the microphone and explain. But so are you talking about temporary cuts into the road that are going to be patched and replaced? If you do, I would look in the PASER rating system, and it talks about patches in, you know, good condition, fair condition, poor condition. If that's going to stay gravel, that's obviously a patch in poor condition. If you're planning on redoing it and patching it, you know, once you patch it, it should be a patch in good condition. Those sewer crossings are gonna have an impact on the life of your road overall. So you will see deterioration likely to occur more quickly in those areas. So it is going to have some impact. So I would certainly consider them. But if it's a temporary thing that you know is going to get fixed, when I'm doing my ratings, I'd make a note of it. Certainly make sure that we have it in our plan to patch that area that's had the cut. And in that case, then I would not really mark it down any lower than just the fact that it's going to be a patch. And you see some guidance in the ratings that talk about patches and patch condition. Can a municipality's PASER info be run as a report to show what percentage of the system are in a given rating, or to produce average ratings for the system as a whole? This would require the system recognizing segment links when producing percentages. Also, stay tuned for this afternoon. We're going to show you that. I will make a comment about averages. When we look at the PASER pavement management tools, it will give you the opportunity to do reports on average rating, to get output on average rating for the system. I don't like average rating as a tool to manage a system, because average rating can hide issues. So especially if, say, you're a growing community and you're getting new footage or mileage of roads dedicated to you through new subdivision development. Well, those roads come in at a 10. They should, if they're being built right and you're inspecting them, making sure they're doing it right. And so that adds mileage to your system. It adds mileage at a 10, which increases your average. But by taking those roads on, you've taken on additional maintenance liability for future years. you haven't, even if you did zero budget on the rest of your system, you could see an increase in average rating. And really you haven't improved the system and you've taken on more future maintenance liability. So there's some reasons that I don't like averages. Also, if you have a system where you've got a lot of roads in poor condition and you've got roads in new condition, you end up getting an average that doesn't really show you that. So when we look at the tools this afternoon, you'll see graphs that are a distribution of those ratings kind of into categories that we find to be a little more meaningful than the average. But WISLR will let you, will calculate the average rating for you. All right. Let's see. I think the only one I missed is I want to print out the pavement rating sheet to take with me while rating the roads. How is this done?
All right. I can definitely walk through that again. So got my screen shared. Thank you, Nick. So this again is through the spreadsheet download. So I'm going to hide these error messages so it looks a little normal. So we've got application functions, our third row of buttons, and you've got spreadsheet instructions. So if we click on that, this will open an Adobe PDF with the instruction sheet for your spreadsheet. However, we also have print and download spreadsheet. So what you do is you click on print and download, and then click OK. And then it should download. So I've got this download. It's going to be this Excel spreadsheet. And if we were to open, it will open in Microsoft Excel. And here's our spreadsheet. And this is what you can print out to take on the roads with you. So normally it is legal sized paper. That's what it's made for because it's a little bit long. But sorry, let me just slow down here. But what you would do is you would print it normally. So on Excel, it's going to file at the top left and then print. And then you might have to click this enable printing button here. And then even though it's a legal size paper, if your printer doesn't support legal, I think it automatically will fit it onto an 8.5 by 14 sheet for you, but it'll be a bit shrunk down. It's gonna look a little bit funny, but these pavement rating columns themselves, they will still show up fine. So yeah, if you don't have legal, it's still printable and you just click print and it'll send it to your printer. Okay, looks like Matt has a question. In combination with the spreadsheet, is there a way to generate a map showing all of the road? Oh, my chat must be a little delayed. As I mentioned, just stay tuned to the next training over pavement analysis. A lot of exciting features we'll be going over there. Any other questions?
For those questions where we said stay tuned for the 1 o'clock session, Isaac and I will be doing that session. And, you know, hold our feet to the fire. If there's something you asked us and you don't feel like we answered it enough, make sure that you bring it up again in the chat in the afternoon session as well. But I think that the questions related to mapping, related to average pavement condition, related to mapping pavement condition, should all be addressed when we go through the afternoon session. Do we have other questions? Can an updated WISLR manual be ordered? I only see it as a download on the course syllabus. I do not believe that we printed the manual, the current version of the manual. Is that correct?
We don't have a process where we print and send manuals. I know the WISLR website is not fully updated yet. Currently, what you see in the training section, that is the updated manual for the things we went over the trainings, but there's a lot more in that manual that needs to be updated, which is why it looks a little bit old if you're in the actual WISLR website. So
yeah, so Kathy was asking about it and said, I can see it be downloaded in the course syllabus. So the most current version is electronic only in the course syllabus. And Isaac, you're saying that if you download it off the WISLR website today, it would not be that most current version?
That's not the full version, right?
Okay, all right. Any other questions? All right, so there's a question from Dave. We are all paper. All my ratings.
So Dave is asking if he has to fill everything in or if his previous ratings, I believe, if I'm understanding this correctly, are on the website. So yes, so if you previously submitted on paper, all of your ratings are in WISLR already, so you don't need to enter all your old ratings again. You can still send your ratings by paper or by paper, but you can also change to an electronic submission anytime you want. But yeah, you just need to worry about the new ratings. You don't need to worry about what you did before.
All right, and I think the next question is for me. Can PASER ratings manuals be ordered? And I had touched on that in the second session yesterday. Let me, Isaac, okay if I grab the screen?
Take it away.
Sharing, all right. I'll give it back to you if we need to jump back into the software. So you should be seeing now the website for the Transportation Information Center. And to get PASER manuals, go to the resources section of that site. You have an electronic version of the asphalt manual in the course site and downloadable. And so you could, there's two places where you can get these electronically. There's a link that says TIC publications available for download, and there's TIC publications order form. We're going to go to the order form because the order form will give you downloads, or you can also use this to order printed copies. So these are all the publications we offer at the Transportation Information Center. So you're going to see some transportation bulletins that provide kind of a quick 4 to 6 page overview of a topic related to your roads. Below all of those, you see the PASER manuals. So you do have a link if you wanted to download, but if I put in an order quantity of one for each of the manuals, and yeah, obviously if you don't have those types, you don't need to order the ones you don't have, but and then fill in my contact information. Let them know you're not a robot. You can choose to be added to our mailing list. We certainly love for you to do that, but you can click that off if you don't want it. And then you click submit. And when you're ordering single copies and you're a local agency in Wisconsin, those should just be automatically sent to you. There's no cost for those. If you send us in an order where you say, I want 50 of them, somebody will contact you back at your contact information, because there may be some shipping costs or processing costs associated with that. So that's where you can get the printed copies of the PASER manual. That is not the WISLR manual, just those PASER pavement condition rating manuals and other publications that are offered by TIC. So hopefully that addresses that question. So Tyler's question is an interesting one. What's the average time to do pavement ratings from field to data entry, let's say for 50 miles of roads? So I'm going to throw this back to the group. If we have people in the group who are have been doing the rating process, if you were to think about like how many days or how many hours between your field time to do the ratings and your time to do entry, and you know the example is 50 miles of road, which is not kind of a not a bad ballpark estimate of the range that maybe a town road system might be, although there's a big variation in town road systems. Some, you know, there's some that are double that. Anybody have any experience to share on how long that's taking them to do? Because I know from some of the questions that we have people new to doing the ratings, but we also have some folks in the room who are a little more experienced doing it as well. Tyler, so far nobody wants to put it on the line.
So I can give a little bit of input.
Okay.
Especially if you just did your pavement ratings directly on that printed spreadsheet. The actual entry process of itself, it can be quick if you're comfortable and if you don't have internet issues. So for me to do a spreadsheet of 4 or 5 pages, I can usually get that in about 20 to 30 minutes. But my experience is a little bit skewed because I do it a little bit more. But other people can have issues, especially if they have internet trouble. So I would say between 15 minutes to an hour, somewhere in that ballpark is how much you should allot if you need to fit it in a tight schedule.
And now the town of Bloomington responded 5 to 6 months, and maybe they can elaborate on that. I mean, you shouldn't have, I'm going to say, more than a day or two in the field to pick up ratings. The PASER rating process is intended to be a fairly quick process. It's not intended to be something where you're, you know, spending huge amounts of time on each road. And of course, some of the roads that you see, they're broken up into segments. So you know, in Isaac's examples, you saw one road, but it's broken into multiple segments. So you're going to be looking at that all at the same time. that answer for Bloomington is, it says it's from the time I give the patrolman the sheet to when I get it back. So that may have to do also with, you know, obviously it's finding the time to do this among all your other tasks and duties as well. But in terms of, you know, time out in the field, this should not be, you know, if you're spending weeks in the field doing the ratings, you know, give me a call and we'll talk about it and see if there's a way we could streamline that a little bit. You know, town of Bloomington then responds that it takes their patrolman one day to get the, when he finds a day where he can block out a whole day and do it, to get it done. And I don't know exactly how many miles that is. Josh G says approximately 2 days to rate our county system, an hour or two to enter the ratings, depending on how many distractions pop up. And town of Bloomington, that one day was 45 miles. Thank you both for giving that input, and that kind of gives a little bit of of real world input into this. And the next comment is, it varies with workload, can get done in 2 to 3 weeks, start to finish, and transferring everything into the rating system less than a day. Any thoughts on being able to add or upload pictures into the program? I like those kind of questions. I love the wish list things, because we all have wish lists of things that we'd love to be able to do with WISLR. And so I would say that's, you know, a comment that's noted. And certainly when you have things that you would like to be able to do in WISLR, I think that the WISLR staff welcomes that kind of feedback, because as we think about, you know, how WISLR might evolve in the future, having people's input into how things can be improved is certainly something that's of interest. The challenge with adding things like photos is obviously that adds significant amounts of storage space when you start talking about 1,900 plus units of local government that manage roads. And so I'm sure there would be, you know, that would be a major undertaking, but certainly we'll note that that desire, and, you know, giving feedback on other things that would be helpful is useful as well. Christina comments that she and the board do their 50 miles in terms of the the field rating in a day. Richard asked to show how to view the recorded class sessions. So I am going to just click off some buttons here in, not that one. All right. So again, your dashboard for Canvas, when you enter the Canvas course site at canvas.wis.edu, is going to look different than mine. You're most likely only have one course on it, using PASER and WISLR to manage your roads. You click on that. It's going to open up the home page for the course. We have it organized so that really everything you need is under this course materials icon. And so you click on that. And let me see. The link is not there yet because we don't have any recordings in there yet because we're still processing yesterday's recordings. I believe those will be added under the general resources section. You will see a link that will say live session recordings. It is not active right now because none of the recordings have been completed and loaded into the course site yet. We have someone working on processing Tuesday's recordings. So that is where you'll find those. We do have a few minutes left, and you can certainly ask other questions in the chat. While I have the course open, I know about 60 to 70% of folks did do quizzes from the Tuesday session. So I did want to touch on those a little bit. And so let's first go to quiz one. And if you haven't done these, you can still go in and do these. I think the course is set up where you complete the quizzes to unlock the certificate. And you go in and it looks a little different for you because I'm an instructor, so it doesn't show me that and it won't show me the quiz. So I'm going to go back. Let me get out of student view. And so you will have a button that allows you to take the quiz. I'm going to actually go elsewhere to do what I want to do. So let's look at quiz number one. And we'll go to the statistics. So questions. I just wanted to highlight some where there was a little variation in responses. So, well, we can go through them all. So question one, you can view certification report, the CVT map, construction and maintenance forms on the WISLR website. So the answer was false because the statement said you could not. The statement local road certification is conducted every 2 years was false because certification, this is certifying the mileage, is something that's done every year. You cannot view state highway data in WISLR. And you create a WAMS ID to begin the process for accessing WISLR. That's where you create your username and password. And you do need to supply the information mentioned. Shelley went over that in the first session. The view-only access, which is kind of the basic access level of WISLR, does not allow you to update pavement ratings, and it wouldn't allow you to use the pavement management tools we're going to show this afternoon. And let's see. The municipality by clicking the location on the Wisconsin map on the homepage. Actually, the one thing you can do on that map is you can click the county. And you may have noticed that when Isaac was doing the demonstration today, but you're not going to be able to click on your town or your village or your city. You're going to use the drop-down menu. You're going to select the county, and then you're going to select the municipality within the county. we kind of went over view by intersection again in our demonstration today in toggling that on and off. Yes, you can print maps in WISLR. And you can, you cannot update payment ratings on the comments page. You saw here today where you go to update those ratings. So that was quiz number one. And let's go back and look at, let me go back to where I was. And let's just quickly also comment on quiz number two. I think this view that we were looking at before is probably the best way to look at this. By the way, excellent job on the pavement distresses. I think there was almost 100% agreement on distresses. This first one was flushing, which is also sometimes called bleeding. Severity-wise, I rated that a 5, being a higher severity bleeding. There were some responses of 6. You really shouldn't get higher than a 6 with the bleeding, since bleeding is the, you know, is the distress that's going to drive that pavement rating. The next two questions with this photo, which had transverse cracking, everybody identified the distress. And you're going to get to the to the rating based on the spacing of the cracks. So if you look at the pavement rating system, you know, 8 would be spaced 40 feet or more. And you can see the second crack here and the third crack are spaced less than that. These skip dash lines are usually a 30-foot space and a 10-foot line. So you kind of get an idea of the distance between them. This one in the foreground and the second one here might be close to 40 feet, but we're really one level down with that. So we have some that are really in that 10 to 40 range as well. So that was rated a 7. I know it's a little harder when you're looking at photographs. The next one, again, everybody got the distresses, and the one that's really going to drive the rating here is that longitudinal crack in the wheel path. And I think in our exercise, in our practice, we might have actually seen a video of this same road. And so longitudinal crack in the wheel path, not going to get a rating better than a 4. And so that was the correct answer. Next one, the distress is alligator cracking. And again, the alligator skin shape, it looks a little bit different than the block cracking. There can be a little bit of confusion when you get to, you know, block cracking that has progressed to very high severity and they're small blocks, but you tend to get a little more square blocks on a block cracking, and this is more that alligator skin appearance. And so that is alligator cracking, and the coverage is more than 25% of the surface. So because it's more than 25% of the surface, we got to a rating of 2. On at towards descriptions, the first one, the correct answer was on Town Line Road, at Park Road, offset 380 feet, towards Lake Street, offset 120 feet. So you're on road, your at road is where you're starting. The offset tells you where the beginning of the section starts at. So on Town Line Road, at Park, offset 380, towards Lake Street, and then the offset to get to the end is 120. The last one, I had a comment back that, and it still hasn't fixed, even though I thought I saved it again. For some reason, the correct answer said River Road rather than River Drive, so I had at least one person who said I answered something different because I thought it was a trick question. They were all supposed to say River Drive, and so on River Drive, at Main Street, offset plus 500 feet to get to your starting point. Towards First Street, offset 700 feet. Because if you look at this arrow, it's showing the 1,000 feet is the total length of the segment. And so you got to do the 1,000 minus this 300 that's on the other side of First Street. and so your offset would be plus 700 from that intersection. So that one was a little bit tricky. And again, we can't use negative offsets, so we couldn't do a, you know, on River Road from Main Street offset 500 towards second offset negative 300. That would not work because Whistler is not, although it describes it, Whistler is not going to recognize that. And so that was the information on the quizzes. Certainly, if that was kind of a quick review, if you have any other questions about those, please let me know. There's another question that just came up about where will I find the certificate for these classes? When we are done with the four sessions, you will see a, and it should not be open for you right now. You may not see the certificate of participation at this point because you haven't gone through all the sessions. But when you've gone through all the sessions, this certificate of participation link will be live at the bottom of the page with all the course information, all the modules. You will click on that. It will ask you to enter your net ID and password, the same one you use to enter the course site. And then it will give you a PDF file of a certificate for the course. And if you do run into any problems accessing that at the end of the course, please let me know. But at the moment, you probably are not seeing that because it should not be activated for you until you've completed the course. All right, I'm going to stop sharing.
And I got a question about dead ends again. I can
okay, go ahead.
Just walk through an example from the beginning and entering a rating. So let me just bring up Whistler again. So our example, if you see my screen, I'm going to take this dead end at Evan Road. So let me just open the map and just show what's going on here. Okay, so Evan Road. So it's this little road kind of splitting out from Buchanan. So we've got this intersection, Buchanan and Moasis Drive. And it's just going out and it just ends in the middle of nowhere. So whenever you have a situation,
I don't know if, at least I'm not seeing the map. And so I don't know if others, did you show the map?
Oh, I might not be sharing the full screen. Give me one moment here. It says I'm on the screen, but okay.
Now we see the map.
Let me do that again.
Okay.
So, okay, so Ebbett and Buchanan. So, here's Buchanan Street and Moasis. We're at this intersection, and it just splits off into a dead end. So, anytime that you have a road that doesn't go into an intersection, that will be listed as termini as your to location. So if we go back to Whistler, we have Ebbin Road and our at is Buchanan and Moasis. And our to is at termini. So this is our dead end. And to enter our rating, we just put our pavement rating. And that's it. So all the work is just finding which row it's in. And termini usually means dead end. Does that clear up your question? All right.
I see there was a question about third-party costs for doing ratings. That's going to vary a lot depending on, you know, who you have doing the ratings. There may be contractors who would do it. Certainly consultants would do it. I believe there are counties that may do it for local agencies. There is one comment back from one of the participants about what their costs were 2 years ago when they did it for 50 miles of road. And so I think there's probably there'd be a bit of variation in that cost depending on who you were getting to do that work. And there's a comment, we don't have a quiz for 3 or 4. We should, and I will take a quick look during the, just after we get off the session to make sure that if there's something that's not activated, we get it activated for you. We'll take care of that if you're not seeing it now, so that you do see those quizzes when you go to the course site between the sessions or after the sessions today. All right, we are at the end of our time. So if you're not seeing the quizzes, just give me a minute or two. When we wrap up, I will go in and make sure that all the switches are on to display those quizzes, because it looks like one of those switches wasn't flipped to show those quizzes. So I will take care of that when we wrap up the session. Not seeing any other questions. We're at our end time for this session, but we're after our lunch break at 1 o'clock. Again, Isaac will be joining us again. I'll be jumping in a little bit with some examples. We're going to be talking about the pavement management tools. So you will see the ability to do reports on averages, to do reports on condition distributions. You will see the ability to do some mapping of those conditions. You'll see the ability to do 5-year budget plans from WISLR as well. And so please join us again for that session after the lunch break. We will see you back here at 1 o'clock. And again, like Tuesday, if you want to choose to leave your connection open during the lunch hour, that's fine. Or you can disconnect, you reconnect onto the same link where you joined the morning session. So thank you, everybody. We'll see you all at 1 o'clock.
Thank you.